Well, good afternoon, everyone. We'll start now. I know people are slowly coming in, but they will join for the important part of the talk and to hear Dr. Campbell. So I'm Patricia Davidson, Dean of the Johns Hopkins School of Nursing, and I'd really like to welcome all of you to our second annual Lavinia Dock lecture series featuring our guest speaker, Dr. Jacquelyn Campbell. So as you know, in our new strategic plan, we have a new pillar, which is health policy and advocacy. And it's within that context that we decided to set up this exciting lectureship. And it's a very special lecture series because it takes our history and the achievements of historical figures like Lavinia Dock and links them with the work that our school is doing today. And so it's an opportunity to reflect on the progress made, as well as how we look to the opportunities ahead. Now, Dr. Campbell is going to tell you a lot more about Lavinia, but she was a superintendent here in the School of Nursing in the 1890s. And she was a brave and courageous voice to position us as scientists, experts, and social justice advocates. So it's in that background, we're pleased to welcome Dr. Jacquelyn Campbell as our featured speaker, who will present a talk titled Using Nursing Science for Activism for Social Justice in the Footsteps of Lavinia Dock. So Dr. Campbell is Professor and Anna D. Wolf Chair at the school and an internationally renowned expert in the field of domestic and intimate partner violence. Her work has paved the way for a growing body of interdisciplinary knowledge about the experiences of violence and health outcomes, risk assessment for lethal and near lethal domestic violence, coordinated systems responses to address intimate partner violence. She has done research on the intersection of HIV and violence, and also looked at an impressive body of work focusing on the role of strangulation in intimate partner violence. She has mentored generations of researchers in the field across a range of professions. And she has been, like Lavinia, a brave and courageous voice for addressing health inequities of marginalized women, not just in the United States, but across the world. Dr. Campbell is developer, the danger assessment, an instrument to assist abused women in accurately determining their level of danger. And I saw on Twitter on the weekend a new app, Are You Safe? But for Dr. Campbell, I know her proudest accomplishments are in mentorship and supporting junior nursing scholars. And so with that, I thank you all for being here today and congratulate Dr. Campbell on her advocacy and her leadership, and thank her for giving us this important address today. So over to you, Dr. Campbell.
Well, I thank you very much, Dean Davidson, for the opportunity to talk today. And over the weekend, I spent a great deal of time looking at some of the history of Lavinia Dock, and also listening to the first Lavinia Dock address, which was a year ago. And my colleague and friend, Dr. Sarah Zanton, did such a lovely job of that. So if anybody wants to go back and look at it, the one thing that marred it, it was the first Zoom bombing episode we'd ever had. She graciously went on, as did you, and did a fabulous address that people might want to look at. So my colleague, Teresa Brockie, has taught me to start out by acknowledging the original owners of the land. And I am terrible at pronunciation, so I won't try. These were the original Native American tribes that were here in our area. And one of the things we always have to think about is the historical trauma of disease and forced removals In the Revolutionary War, there were some horrific things that were done to our Native American ancestors here in Maryland, and then the boarding school experiences. And Teresa's research is terrific in terms of addressing that historical trauma and how it affects people today who are Native American. And I also wanna pay tribute to Judy Atkinson and Dean Davidson. She just got a big award in Australia. So when you go back, if you would please look her up. And she wrote a wonderful book. It's called Trauma Trails, Recreating Songlines, the Transgenerational Effects of Trauma in Indigenous Australia. And what's beautiful about that book, it not only traces the historical trauma and how that has affected Judy's extended family, but she's also a therapist. And so she does a wonderful job talking about how to heal both our own families when there's been historical trauma and the families of others in terms of preventing ongoing violence. So I'm going to talk about Lavinia. And in her early nursing career, and this picture is probably not from then. It's on where all of us go to find things in Google. And it says it's her. It doesn't look very much like some of the early pictures, but I do love, you know, the stack of books that she's carrying around. And Lavinia came from a relatively privileged background in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. And she was born in 1858. And then she went to Bellevue Hospital School of Nursing at age 26. So it took her a while to figure out that's what she wanted to do. And then she was the night supervisor at Belmont Hospital. So she did her inpatient work. And then she went to the to address community health and disaster nursing at the with the yellow fever epidemic and the Johnstown flood. And she served with Clara Barton there. Then there's the Hopkins years from 1890 to 1896. So a relatively short time. She was first the assistant superintendent under Isabel Hampton Robb. And at that point, the superintendent was also the dean of the School of Nursing, as well as the superintendent of nursing in the hospital. She wrote her first book in 1890, and it was financed by her father. It was the first nurse's drug manual called Materia Medica for Nurses, went on to sell 100,000 copies. So that was her first nursing science contribution. It was followed by multiple books and publications throughout her career. In 1893, she gave a speech at the World's Fair, which was in Chicago, and urged the declaration of nursing as a profession. It wasn't then, to establish nursing authority in medicine. She campaigned for legislation for nurses to control their own profession. So these were some of her first policy endeavors. In 1893, Doc, Isabel Hampton Robb and Mary Adelaide Nutting, who was one of Doc's students at Hopkins, founded the American Society of Superintendents of Training Schools for Nurses of the United States and Canada. And that's now the NLN. She also founded the Nurses Associated Alumni Association, which is now the ANA. Then she went on in 1896 to, with Lillian Wald, to provide community health, public health nursing care for poor immigrant families. In looking at her history, I was struck by the fact that all of these amazing nursing leaders knew each other. Most of them were lifetime friends. There were some rifts here and there. But one of the things she wrote about is how she began to think for the first time at this wonderful endeavor at the Henry Street settlement. And she also began to develop a strong sympathy with oppressed classes. a lively sense of justice and a keen love of liberty. And that's from one of her articles. She and the other public health nurses became the chief authorities on immigrant health and public health reform in New York City. So again, taking her practice, taking it to policy, which I was so impressed with how she did that throughout her career. She also joined the Women's Trade Union League and the Equality League of Self-Supporting Women. And these were pretty radical organizations. She participated in the New York's shirtwaist strike in 1909. And that was part of her activism that she did throughout the rest of her career. She continued to contribute to nursing science. She wrote Hygiene and Morality. And part of that book was about combating what they called then venereal disease, we would call STIs. But also one of the ways she felt like it was necessary to combat venereal disease was with contraception. And she continued work with the nursing profession. At that point, she helped organize the formal National Association of Colored Nurses. And that eventually Black nurses formed their own organization in 1971. One of the things I love about the Henry Street settlement, first of all, I love that picture of the nurse climbing over the roofs to provide nursing care. But particularly that now the Henry Street settlement, which still exists in New York City, and runs four homeless shelters, and one of them is for domestic violence survivors and their children. So then Lavinia went to Washington, D.C. and joined the advisory council of the National Woman's Party. This was the radical wing of the suffragists. So she was way on that radical wing. Was a radical feminist and in the first wave of feminism. She took part in the 1912 suffrage hike from New York City to Albany. And then in 1913, the suffrage walk or hike from New York City to DC. She was arrested four times from 1917 to 1918. And when I think about that, I think about our own alumni, Catherine Long, who was arrested several times in the protests around the Supreme Court nominee that would that was part of his agenda is to end the women's right to choose. She continued to contribute to scholarship. In 1917, she wrote an article in the Suffragist, an article that ended with her most famous quote, "The young are at the gates," which is a rallying cry during picketing at the White House. We also think in terms of now that our youthful colleagues are the ones that are gonna take over on health policy, on social justice issues that nurses are more and more involved in. She continued to work in women's health policy, again, advocating for venereal disease treatment and access to birth control information. She strongly supported Margaret Sanger, and she did this in a very famous speech at the New York Academy of Medicine. And these are some photographs of her. The one in the hat when she's quite a bit older, I'm not sure when that, there's no attribution on what date that was, but she did retire at 64. But most of her activism work was in her 50s and early 60s. So I was very proud and happy to see that. So one of the things in the legacy of Lavinia Dock, Wikipedia says that she withdrew from nursing when she took up activism. I begged different. I say she kept doing quintessential nursing, combining nursing science practice and activism. And But as admirable as she was, using lessons from nursing science practice and feminist activism to address health and national policy, the suffragists were mostly white. And even the radical wing of such suffragist activism has been judged by history to have asked Black women to support them, but not willing to be true partners with them, nor address the voting suppression laws and racism issues that were so rampant in the country at that point. And there was not any hint that she was individually racist, but she did contribute to systemic racism, as most people in the United States, except for people of color, did in those days. So even though we admire what she did, we also need to recognize that her social and science activism was for women and workers and immigrant families, but not for Black women and families. And she recognized systemic racism, but not systemic sexism, I'm sorry, but not racism. So I am more and more intrigued with the thought that I am standing on the shoulders of nursing activists like Lavinia Dock. My nursing education at Duke way back when was between 64 and 68, after my childhood in Western New York State. I learned a lot about Southern structural racism, horrific health inequities. The Martin Luther King assassination happened in the spring of my senior year, and then Bobby Kennedy's assassination, and what we called then the riots. If you have a chance to watch Chicago 7, the new documentary, it puts that whole era in a much more realistic context. And what we thought about as riots then were peaceful protests that, like our more recent protests, some people portrayed as being violent. My early nursing career was in Dayton, Ohio. I did a little inpatient pediatric work. Then I was a school nurse in an inner city high school. Roosevelt High School was the name. That's where I learned much more about health inequities and social activism. That high school was 99% Black students. The Black Panthers were in our neighborhood and provided breakfast. And I remember Sarah talking in the first address about her work interviewing the Black Panthers and how they provided breakfasts in the neighborhoods and how I learned that they were incredibly good neighbors and addressing some of the justice issues as well as health issues. I learned more through them and other partners about partnering with NGOs, about child abuse. And then I started the MSN program at Wright State University. That program was overtly feminist. Peggy Chin was one of the leaders in that program. It was also very much policy oriented. One of the things that I did as part of that program was partnered with young women who had graduated from Roosevelt High School. That's where I learned that the number one cause of death for young Black women then was homicide. Now it's the number three cause of death for young Black women. I did my thesis on homicide of women in the Dayton Police Department. My faculty encouraged me to do that. I'm probably the only master's educated nurse that did her thesis in a police department looking at homicide records. I was encouraged that this is indeed nursing science. What I found was the majority of those women were abused before they were killed. And this was at the time of the first domestic violence shelters. I moved to Detroit, taught at Wayne State University, and volunteered in the shelters. And that's where I developed, based on that early nursing research on homicide, the danger assessment for the first time. I developed it with women in domestic violence support groups. I have found in my thesis that when women were murdered, the majority were murdered by a husband, boyfriend, or ex, and the majority abused before they were killed. So I've volunteered at the local Detroit battered women's shelter, abused women's shelter. I wanted to learn more about domestic violence, and I wanted to help prevent those horrific homicides. It doesn't happen very often, but I worked with women to help them see for themselves how much danger they were in. I developed it, the danger assessment in 1985. I was using the self-care agency concepts of Dorothea Oram in order to help women increase their ability to take care of themselves. And so I developed the original danger assessment, did a lot of small study research, had 10 samples and interviewed 2,251 abused women myself to establish preliminary reliability and validity. The danger assessment uses a calendar. It's interactive. It's meant to be used with women. The calendar aids their recall. And it's much more persuasive in an adult learner, strong woman survivor model. I first developed it as a clinical tool. I was trying to do good nursing practice. But one of the things in studying homicide, I oftentimes found myself in the company of criminologists with public health researchers. So I had to be able to explain why was a nurse in this space? Why was it nursing science? I had to explain it to my peers. There were many people in nursing that weren't sure this was really nursing research. I also learned that the community has a lot to do with what happens to abused women. So I started working with other nurses and we started an organization that's called the Nursing Network on Violence Against Women. It's international. It is still going strong, and it's a very student-friendly organization with very inexpensive dues. But part of what we did together was working on the health outcomes of intimate partner violence and working with the rest of the country to help identify abused women in nursing care. This is the danger assessment. This is the ROC curve analysis of the danger assessment that we established in a big study of intimate partner homicide that was done at Hopkins. It was my first big research grant that I got at Hopkins, funded by NIH, CDC, and NIJ. And this validation of the danger assessment was very important in making it considered a useful instrument. So again, combining science with what had started out to be a practice instrument. Since then, part of what we learned in that original study was that women in the study were murdered when they were pregnant and immediately afterwards. And so I became more and more interested in the whole issues of maternal mortality. This is definitely nursing science, looking at the homicide and suicide and substance abuse disorder, overdose deaths that are also happen during pregnancy or in the immediate postpartum. One of the things in the new attention to maternal mortality is we have recognized in our own alumni and colleague, Lauren Underwood, is leading the charge in the House on maternal mortality issues, especially for Black women. But if you look at that chart, Native American women are also disproportionately affected by maternal mortality. And part of their maternal mortality is also homicide or suicide. Firearms are very much involved with this. We did an analysis from the MVDRS in terms of the suicide amongst abused women. Suicide, substance abuse disorder, and obviously homicide are very much related to domestic violence. There's other forms now of the danger assessment. There is the DAI for immigrant women that Dr. Sabri has helped develop with me. There's also the DAR, which is for women in same-sex relationships that Dr. Nancy Glass has worked with. Athena Sherman, one of our PhD graduates, is working on a version of the danger assessment for transgender people primarily, but also looking at the other issues for non-binary people in domestic violence and risk factors. We also worked with the Maryland Network Against Domestic Violence to develop the LAP, which is a short form of the danger assessment for police, and the DA5, which is meant for healthcare system. But the most famous one is Dr. Glass's My Plan, and her app is available. It's incredibly well known throughout the world, and she deserves great kudos for having developed that app. And the danger assessment, I'm very proud to say, is part of that app. So in part, looking at those health outcomes related to intimate partner violence, and this is Ann Coker's framework that I've been working on since then and added the ACEs to it, because we know that many abused women have experienced many adverse childhood events. And when they have, that makes all these health outcomes all the worse. There's much stronger processes that go on. And it's important that we look at this from a nursing framework because of the holistic issues here, that we're not only looking at like behavioral outcomes, not only looking at mental health outcomes, but we're also looking at the physical health outcomes. We've done some research that shows that old injury is oftentimes makes some of the physical health symptoms that much worse. We've also looked at some of the physiological issues. My colleague, Jessica Gill, has worked with me on those issues. So we find chronic disease more prevalent amongst abused women. And one of the things I oftentimes tell everyone that sleep problems are what women come to the healthcare system the most often with. And those sleep problems being a compilation of a trauma, cumulative trauma oftentimes. Plus, it's hard to sleep when you're sleeping next to the person who supposedly loves you the most, but also is abusive towards you. So that's part of these health issues that sometimes, you know, all the sleep hygiene in the world is not going to help an abused woman sleep. We need to do some other healing kinds of interventions with her. My colleague and friend, Dr. Phyllis Sharps, has addressed the issues of abuse during pregnancy, has formulated the Dove intervention with Dr. Linda Bullock, that is one of the few RCT tested and found to be effective interventions for abused women that can be done within any home visiting situation. I also was fortunate enough to turn some of this work into policy and helped with the National Academy of Medicine report on women's health and the US Preventive Health Task Force report on routine screening for abused women in the healthcare system. So that system change approach, also very much a nursing approach. And one of the things as we went along is working particularly with Dr. Doris Campbell, who is now deceased, and Dr. Phyllis Sharps, in terms of the health inequities for Black women. It was not only the homicide that was inequity in maternal mortality, but also many of these other health problems affect Black abused women even more so than white. One of the things we found, for instance, is that although domestic violence does not cause hypertension, is that abused women who are Black are more likely to develop hypertension at a younger age and find it more difficult to control their hypertension than non-abused Black women. Indigenous women, Teresa Brockie taught me almost everything I know about the health inequities in that arena for abused women. There's also the Murdered and Missing Indigenous Women Project that I've been working with through a PhD student, M. Lorzel. HIV, those issues, Michael Ralph, who used to be here at Hopkins, and then Jason Farley and Jocelyn Anderson taught me all about that. And now Derek Dangerfield and Joyelle R. Scott are teaching me more. Part of what I've always wanted to do is to improve that, well, not always, always, but for the most part, to improve the healthcare system response to intimate partner violence. One of the things we learned in that intimate partner homicide study was that 47% of the women who were murdered were in the healthcare system in the year before they were killed. Only 4% were seeing anyone from a domestic violence service organization or even in touch with a hotline, according to a loved one. About 20-some percent were in touch with the police. The emergency department study that we did was first at Johns Hopkins Hospital, and then a multi-site study funded by CDC. Deb Troutman, who's now at AACN as the ED executive director, did her dissertation research about in Hopkins ED in terms of increased disclosure if you use electronic screening, that many times women are more likely to be willing to tell an electronic system about abuse, especially if we don't give them the opportunity verbally to disclose abuse in a way they can respond. Policy initiatives. I was lucky enough to be part of the original VAWA funding, Violence Against Women Act funding, and part of those hearings. And it was a totally grassroots collaborative with domestic violence advocates all over the country and nurses. We've now, Carmen Alvarez is doing some really important work in terms of trying to allow abused women to disclose, no matter what their background, to ask in a way that they can take advantage of that opportunity. I'm working with the VA. The VA is now screening all patients. They ask everybody, male and female, if they use violence against their partner and if they're experiencing violence against their partner, from their partner. This way, it takes away the pejorative victim versus perpetrator kinds of language. It's much less stigmatizing. I was able to testify to the U.S. Senate Armed Services Subcommittee in 2018. So the policy work has continued. And I've always said the most effective policy, the best hearings are when it's a combination of stories and numbers. We call it mixed methods research. Oftentimes in those hearings, they will bring a victim forward to tell her or his story about what happened in an abusive relationship. And then also bring in someone who has the science, who has the numbers. And that has been very effective with the National Academy of Medicine, with Congress, DHHS, DOJ, the Office of Violence Against Women. And I'm always very clear that I'm coming to those hearings, that I'm testifying as a nurse, that I am bringing my nursing science, my nursing practice experience to my policy work. And it's not just federal policy. I've been lucky enough to be involved there, but I'm very much involved with state policy and also with the city. This is the model we developed. And I say we, Jocelyn Anderson was very much a part of it in terms of that it's the one of the things that people have been talking about in terms of abused women being more at risk for HIV is that they are, it's hard, it's impossible to negotiate safe sex if you're not in, if you're in a relationship that's violent. Negotiation doesn't happen in those kinds of relationships. And particularly if you're being physically forced into sex. The forced sex is not only forced vaginal sex, it's also forced anal sex. But importantly, from the physiological viewpoint and that quintessential nursing possibility is that immune system dysfunction by that constant stress of being abused. Plus, if you're a woman, a Black woman, there's also the stress of racism. Those stressors also accumulate and affect one's immune system. One of the things we also find is that if you're abused, you're much more likely to have an STI, Lavinia's venereal disease. And that STI also affects your the ability of one's vagina to block the HIV virus, makes it much less possible, I mean, much more possible for the virus to be acquired, to go through the vaginal wall. And so again, bringing that holistic perspective, it's not just behavior, it's also the physiology. We also found, and this is what where Jocelyn's work came in, that there was more chance of progression of the disease if you were abused. So it's a complex continuum. The trauma-informed care needs to be done, but also some of the prep work that people like Kamala Alexander is doing is incredibly important for abused women. So another model that we have worked on is the notion that when we give women the opportunity and men to disclose that they're experiencing or using violence against a partner, but particularly in terms of experiencing violence, that when we recognize that childhood trauma, those ACEs is part of that picture. And then if you have intimate partner violence on top of it, that injury is part of what old injuries, oftentimes untreated injuries, cumulative injuries is part of that picture. Then the physical health problems that women experience, the brain injury, traumatic brain injury, not only in terms of her head being banged up against walls, slammed up against the floor, punches to the face, all of these are insults to the brain and it happens over and over again. So we get that cumulative traumatic brain injury. It's also from strangulation. And Michelle Patch, who's now part of our faculty, did her dissertation on strangulation in abused women. So that another cumulative trauma to the brain through anoxia. And this trauma response is something that in a nursing approach to abused women, we're not only concerned about her safety, but we're also concerned about these health outcomes. And that we need to tell her, talk to her about why she is having some of these symptoms, why she is having some of these health problems. It's incredibly empowering to her. And if it's with that explanation that it's the whole person, I'll never forget talking to one woman who said, oh, well, you mean it's not just because I'm crazy, that there's also reasons for all these symptoms that I'm having that are part of my physiology. And that means there are some health interventions that can be done to help her, as well as a warm referral to domestic violence services if she's currently in an abusive relationship. And the part of that needs to be helping her get interventions for him. Most abused women want him to do better, get better, be healed, not just escape. In fact, leaving that relationship is only over after a long time, after she's tried everything she can think of. He's the father of her children. She wants him to learn how to get better, to do better, but also to help heal him, since he has so often, as a child, witnessed domestic violence and or have been abused. So that we want increased safety for her, and it may be while she's staying in the abusive relationship, as well as increased safety in terms of leaving. The My Plan app can be incredibly helpful to her in that way. But we also, through that kind of her sense, oh, I can do something. There are some things I can do. There are some ways I can get him to help. The House of Ruth Maryland has a wonderful program for abusers. That pays attention to their whole lives and their experiences of violence, as well as what they're doing now. It's called the Gateway Project. And this decreased stress that's when you're finding out that there's things you can do both for your health and your mental health and your safety, that increased sense of efficacy. And then we're going to have down the line, doesn't happen right away, but improved physical and mental health. So one of the things I got very involved in this healthcare policy, I was spending a lot of time in DC. It's very, in a way, impressed with myself and impressed with what we were doing around domestic violence. And then the Freddie Gray killing happened here in Baltimore. And so as I was brought back home, I'd always been concerned about health inequities, the domestic violence, homicide, and trauma health outcomes. But I was thinking more on an individual abused woman's level. And when Freddie Gray was killed, and you know, there's still disagreements about all of that. In order to make this progress on decreasing violence, I had to start paying attention to violence in general. I had to start thinking about the violence and injustice being done in our communities, the trauma trails that Judy Atkinson in Australia had written so eloquently about in both extended families and in our communities. So it reinforced my need to collaborate across sectors. Healthcare system has to be an integral part of the community. And one of the things during that period, as I read Ta-Nehisi Coates' Between the World and Me, and it's if you haven't read it, it takes place right here in Baltimore. It's an incredibly instructive read. If you did not grow up in a neighborhood that was violent, in a home where parents turned to the belt in order to protect their children, And how that was experienced by the brilliant Ta-Nehisi Coates. And there's also toxic stress research now in terms of what happens to kids' brains when they're constantly experienced to exposed to trauma and violence in their homes and in their neighborhoods. And one of the things we sometimes talk about microaggressions. Well, excuse me, it's a macroaggression. It's a violent experience. If you're stopped by the police, slammed to the sidewalk, you know, those kinds of things are macroaggressions. And we in Baltimore, as well as elsewhere in the country, are the downstream effects of redlining of those racist practices, but also the bias in our justice system that men who are Black are too often incarcerated, and so are young women who are Black. And you know, this is just a map from the Freddie Gray, the uprisings afterwards, the confluence of things that happened in Mojaman Mall when kids were dumped off of their school buses and caught in that mayhem with no way to escape because the city thought that they ought to stop the bus service that would have taken them home. And where we had that unrest was in the neighborhoods of the starkest health inequities, the lowest life expectancies, the most empty buildings, the poorest schools, the highest concentrations of incarceration, and a history of segregation policies. And that fire that erupted was a construction fire. It had nothing to do with the protests or the incidents of where there was looting. And now, as I mentioned, I think a lot about the trauma trails of brain injury. Oftentimes, the shaken baby as a child abuse victim can lay the foundations. We know about CTE, chronic traumatic encephalitis, that happens to football players. Do we think about it with abused women? And now there's three competing brain banks that are asking for the brains of abused women so that they can do those same types of CTE tests. And I say, let us get women to the right resources before that. As I mentioned, Michelle Patch's PhD is a wonderful, she's publishing those articles now, and it's very instructive around the strangulation experiences of abused women. And the it was just published in the Journal of Emergency Nursing. So all of this work is incredibly important. Hopefully people will go on and work more on that. There's a whole cadre of interdisciplinary people that are working on it, as well as from the nursing perspective. So one of the things in my own personal resolve now is, especially since George Floyd's murder and Breonna Taylor's killing is the anniversary is this week. We must all examine and confront that structural racism and biases in all of our systems. Work like that of Sarah Zanton, Diana Baptiste, Yvonne Commodore Mensa. We need to help dismantle that structural racism. It will be long and it will be hard. It takes a long time to address these issues. And I am more and more aware of how it's also happening in domestic violence systems. Are those who use violence who are Black or Hispanic or Indigenous more likely to be held accountable? Yes, with jail, with convictions, with bail, with gun removals, because they've had priors. And this is oftentimes the result of structural racism. Beth Ritchie's book, Arrested Justice, is a compelling read about how this has affected women. And how much does all of this contribute to the health inequities I've been trying to address? It contributes mightily. Abused women from marginalized groups are more likely to lose custody of their children. And people who from groups that we marginalize who are experiencing partner violence are oftentimes even less likely to call the police than other abused women. Afraid, are they afraid the police will kill their partners? Afraid the partner will go to jail? She doesn't want him to go to jail. He's the father of their children. But what about those domestic violence victims who are in fear of their lives? How do we reach out, especially now in a pandemic? And there is some evidence that domestic violence is exacerbated when an abuser can isolate a victim even more. So one of the things I'm trying to do is become an agent of healing from trauma for my community, as well as for the youth in the community. And one of the things I'm very invested in doing is facilitating our PhD students, our other students, to do that work. So I keep on trying to stand on the shoulders of Lavinia Dock, of Fannie Guess and Johansson, of Phyllis Sharps, to use nursing science for activism, for social justice. And I'm becoming clearer all the time about the importance of the nursing science part. And this is a quote from one of the moms of one of the women who was killed. Never forget who is for. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jackie. That was emotional, inspirational, and informative. So while people are getting their thoughts together and some questions, I thought I might just start by saying that we were just so excited to hear on International Women's Day that President Biden is, you know, setting up a committee to look at gender equity. Is there anything that we should be thinking about in terms of positioning to have a voice there?
Well, trust me, there are voices there already, and there are continuing to be queries in different committees. I just did some recommending of some of our own faculty to be on a couple of committees in that space. But the Violence Against Women Act needs to be reauthorized. And it will be coming up. It will be reintroduced. Anybody that wants to be part of that huge collaborative interdisciplinary crowd that's working on it, even as we speak, I can get you in touch with the right people. They'll take volunteers from anyone. And then when it is introduced, we need to be a strong force. Nurses to support the Violence Against Women Act when it comes up for reauthorization. It will be incredibly important, and it will have health components in the new version, as well as some of the safety and domestic violence funding.
Thanks, Jackie. Has anybody got any questions or comments? I can't see any questions in the chat.
This is Sarah Zanton. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can, Sarah. Thank you.
Sorry, I just wanted to say, Jackie, that was one of the most moving hours I've ever spent, and I so appreciate the trajectory of your work and to hear all about it, and thank you.
Thank you, Sarah.
Yeah, I'll just also echo what Sarah said. It was so moving and wonderful, and just such a great look at what's possible, the vision that we can have this of health in every area of our lives. And I love that you included the biology in there too. And because I think that could potentially be the key to people who maybe don't care about interpersonal violence as much, because if we can lower costs in a preventative sort of way of chronic disease progression, because, you know, there's avenues to get stakeholders involved, through these other mechanisms. And I think create this consensus around moving policy, because we have this great quote unquote natural science data, which we shouldn't need to have, but it's like another way that we can create wings that put more people in into the party. So thank you for including that too. I hope that can help move people into the group, the fold.
Thanks so much, Melissa. And so Jackie, I'll be sure to comment, to copy off the chat, because people are saying lots of lovely things. Anyone else maybe want to just make one comment before we close? So maybe I will let Kathy McDonald have the last word, because I think she sums it up. She just wrote in the chat, very motivational in many ways. Thank you, Jackie. So I think that's a great way to end this session. Thank you so much, Jackie, for giving us your wisdom, and thank you for all the work you do. And this is just such an amazing place. And from the day that the doors opened in 1889, phenomenal nurses are doing amazing things to change the world. So thanks so much, everybody. Please enjoy the rest of your day. And I'm going to quickly copy the chat box for Jackie before the session ends. So thanks so much, everyone. And we look forward to next year's Lavinia Dock Talk. And just remember, we're laying groundwork for all of us to be advocates and engaging in health policies. So thank you so much, everybody, for taking the time today. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.